Greetings from the moon base. Planted the flag over there. Howdy. So, 83 people. Just getting through the introduction. I probably look a lot clearer than in the past broadcast because I'm transmitting at 720p at 15 frames per second, so almost all the resolution, half the speed, which is what you get on the moon. And we're in the green. It's about just after 6 o'clock in Philadelphia, and everybody in town has left for the long weekend. And I think the reason I'm in the green right now is that there is nobody in my neighborhood. I'm like the only one. If I had known the bandwidth would have been this good, I'd broadcast at 30 frames. But yeah, this just proves my contention that it's all about the bottleneck. So when everyone leaves town, man, cable's gonna look really good tonight. I'm the last holdout in Philly. So, had I only known, I could have gone, I could have gone full 1080p tonight. So, anyway, how are you? I'm looking at the chat. Hey, saw hello from the People's Republic of Ireland. How are you? The Jersey Channel Islands. Hey. All right. Well, I'm not going to make this one as long as the last live chat that I've done. Hopefully I'm in synchronization because I did change the settings on the encoder for this. So if my sound and video are not in sync, someone put something on the chat because I can't see myself in real time. So we are still in the green. This is amazing. Hey from Scotland. Hey. Yeah. What's the flag? That's the universal flag of everybody else. Yeah. Claiming the moon for everyone. Hey, Montreal. Yeah, fan noise. People complained last time, so there's a big fan running in the background. Yeah, well, that's the fan in my Asus 8 core. The encoder is screaming clock right now, so yeah. So using the processors, because I don't have a dedicated external, encoder. So using the system to flop my video. And hey, Hamburg. So I did this video I put up a couple days ago. The shootout between the new Fuji instant camera, the Instax, and my old land camera. Probably too long for most people, but it's sort of my traditional long format. It's actually shorter. I was going to put a lot more in there because I was going to have all this about the mechanics of the pack film and stuff, but it would have been like an hour and a half long. So I'm currently making a follow-up video about the mechanics of instant film because I thought it really needed its own video because I'm building some three-dimensional models in the lab right now to show how the process works because when I shot the video, I had all the stuff talking about the process, but then I was like, man, this can't be an hour and a half long video, and I just kept cutting it down and down and down. But there's a lot of very interesting stuff in the way that those instant cameras work, because they all work on the principle of just having simple single lens, so it's camera obscura. And so when you have a simple lens, the image is upside down and backwards. Not just upside down, but upside down in mirror image. So it's like, how do you put that on a print? Well, believe me, there's some really intricate origami involved between the positive and the negative on both of the cameras to take a a picture that's upside down and backwards and make it right side up. And it's also the answer to the question, why is there such a big difference between the image resolution of the Instax type film and those sort of Instamatic self-developing films? Why are those films so kind of mushy and blurry as opposed to the pack film, which is so sharp and crisp and has good color? And the answers to that are largely in the way that the process goes and the mechanics involved and how that image is transferred. And I'm going to make a video about that this weekend. I'm in the process of doing that. Hey, Lisbon! Ooh! Lisbon, yes. Portugal! Yeah. Instant film is now called digital. No, it's not the same thing. Not the same thing. Not at all. People caught all the ELO stuff. Because, yeah, I saw Jeff Lynne's ELO last week. It was a sadly short set. They didn't have anything. They didn't have anything out of the ELO catalog after 1980, except for a couple songs off of Jeff's recent projects. Which was sad, because when they did the Wembley show last year, they pulled out stuff from Time and Xanadu and Rock and Roll is King, and did some of those early 80s songs, which were really good, when he had like the really big modern production sound on ELO, which I do like that era of ELO a lot. But they didn't have any of that at the show in Philly. It was just the 70s era. Yeah, it was the top 20 hits. And it was a short show. I think the whole thing clocked in about under 70 minutes with the encore, one song encore. It was just happened so fast. But they did have a great laser show. It was a kind of a throwback to the Out of the Blue. It was like Out of the Blue tour times 10, because they had like 1,000 lasers, 1,000 green lasers firing off. Lasers. Like the deadly lasers that we have here on the moon, from the moon base. But I got the other strange thing about the show is that they didn't have any records for sale. I would have thought that at the ELO show they would have had like a merch booth that had like all the albums and stuff. I brought a bag like to buy some of the more recent records on vinyl. I thought they would have them there, but no, they didn't. No records. But I ended up ordering the new Jeff Lynne's ELO. Yep. Alone in the Universe. Let's see if we're getting there. Yeah. Yep. This is a fantastic album. And the cover art, it's very evocative of the Out of the Blue Age ELO, because of the gatefold. Take a look at this. Look at the gatefold art. Look at that. It's just like Out of the Blue. It's got some Easter eggs in it. It's got an ELO coffee mug here on one side. Right here. And another Easter egg here. Where is it? Right there. Voyager record. Right there. Kind of. Getting a lot of glare. But anyway. And Jeff Lynne on the back. Yeah. I was a bit perplexed with this tour about why is it Jeff Lynne's ELO? That's like Paul McCartney's Beatles. Or Pete Townsend's The Who. So it seemed a little perplexing until I got the new record, because as it turned out, all the tracks on this record, Jeff Lynne played all of the tracks. He's credited as, that's not, it's in the other one, but drums, keyboard, piano, vibes, bass, guitar, vocals. I think the only guest on here, I think, is his daughter, does some background vocals, but it's basically, he's the whole band, so that made perfect sense, Jeff Lynne's ELO, because he did all the parts in this. But some really great tracks. I'm not going to play the music because, you know, the Google bots will slam me, but there are some tracks on there that are right out of Time, like the Time era production, you know, that really big sound, like Twilight, you know, which is, one of my favorite songs, Twilight, which they played at Wembley, but they didn't play last week. I was really bummed. But that really, really big early 80s Yellow sound, some of that is on the new record. 2001-ish, yes. Yes, 2001. Someone's being mean already. Why get on the chat if you're just going to diss what I'm talking about? It's like, why are you here? Well, it's like, trolls, do something else. Do something else with your life. Get off my channel. Yes, always liked the Yellow, more Beatlesque sound. Well, Jeff Lynne is the seventh Beatle, or the eighth Beatle. Because George Martin was the, well, technically, Pete Best was the, well, Stuart Sutcliffe was the first fourth Beatle, then Pete Best, then George Martin could be was the third member to be considered the fifth Beatle. And there was, well, there were a few other people who helped them out in the later Beatles years that were kind of considered members of the band, people that played on various tracks and stuff. But Jeff Lynne really kind of ended up being like the real fifth Beatle, especially in later years, and produced the last Beatles album in the 90s, of course, and George Harrison and all that stuff. Yeah. Let some regulars be moderators. Yeah, well, that's if we do this more. There's a way they let you do that, but you gotta list people, so people have to get on a dibs list to moderate. If anybody wants to get on a dibs list to moderate, kind of just say so in the chat. Unless, of course, you're a troll that want to give dibs to moderate, but you're actually a troll and you'll end up trolling as a moderator. Okay. One more thing on the vinyl. I do buy some of the new re-releases because even with some of the older bands, like Big Star, they're re-releasing some deep tracks. Like, you know, bands that maybe had, like, B-sides or stuff that normally would have just popped up on later CD issues. They're putting out as new, like, album releases. And there was a new Big Star, which was sort of like, almost like the UK release. Because in America, the first Big Star record, number one record, and the first two records were released separately. But in the UK, they released them as a single double record set gatefold vinyl, which is actually like highly sought after in the US now. But they sort of did the same thing with this re-release with the best of Big Star, which is pretty much like the first two records with some extra tracks and totally remastered, you know, 180 gram vinyl, you know, really high bandwidth digital remaster, you know, a lot more high end and all that stuff. So I was really excited and I got the record and put on the first side. It was, wow, this is fantastic, sounds great. Flipped it over to the B-side and wah, wah, wah. It was a misprint. The second side, it was all like, you know, it was printed off center, so it was basically going around and it was kind of going like this. And so it was going around. What made it worse is it was 45 RPM, 12-inch. Look, so a lot of these reissues, they press them, cut them at 45 RPM to get the higher, you know, resolution, which just makes it worse. If you have a misprint on the disc, it just makes the error all that more apparent because it's spinning faster. And I had to take it back, and now I'm waiting for a replacement from the distributor. It's a big pain in the ass, but you're gonna sell a record that costs a lot of money, and it takes time to print, and it takes a lot of resources to make a record and ship a record and stock a record, and you're not even going to check the pressings, like, not even going to inspect them, because they would have had to know that they made a run of them that were, you know, misprinted like that. It's like, not really, no real excuse for that, you know, if you can't check every now and then that the stamper on your press has come loose and is just wobbling around in the press for 1,000 copies or something. It's like, what a waste. So, but anyway, that's my vinyl rant. We are still in the green. This is unprecedented. It's all because there's nobody in my neighborhood. There's nobody using, like, those internets in my neighborhood. And I could have gone full, like, HD on this. It's incredible. Christchurch, New Zealand. Hey, Kiwis. Yeah. I was just thinking about NZ today. I was thinking about, because I'm going to be doing another guest slot on WPRB in the next few weeks, which I'll announce and all, but I've been putting together a playlist because I'm going to be doing a guest DJ slot. And I have a New Zealand set I'm doing because I'm a huge New Zealand pop fan. I'm a huge Split Enz fan and all the spin-off bands of Phil Judd, you know, Schnellfenster and all that, Mel Crombie. People in New Zealand are going to be like, what the hell? How can Fran know about all that great stuff? But yeah, I love New Zealand pop music. It's always been a favorite. So. 720p, she kinda take it, Captain. She kinda take the strain. Yeah, oh yeah. She can't take the strain. Warp drive's overheating. Scotty, we need warp speed in 10 minutes or we're all dead. That, of course, is the Star Trek intercom panel that was sent in this past week. What a great gadget. So yeah, you're hearing it live. It's nighttime in the Netherlands. It sure is. Sure is. What are you drinking, Fran? I'm drinking Darjeeling tea. It's my favorite tea. Darjeeling. Hey from the UK. Okay. Before I get into the chat and everything and take your questions, the other thing I wanted to show you is, let's see if I get this to work. Ah, okay. New York Times had an article about that New Horizons, right? I mean, New Horizons made history with the flyby of Pluto, one of my favorites. And those of you who are the top Team FranLab members, they got a swag pack, and I'm still going through my Pluto stamps. If it's international, I use the Pluto stamps because I got to put extra stamps on. But New Horizons is not done. It's actually headed to intercept one of the new the first Kuiper Belt object after Pluto, which is 2014 MU69. So they have these enhanced photos here. This photo on the left is actually the unenhanced shot. It's just all these stars flooding out, but they knew where this object was, and they blocked out all the stars and got this little dot here. And that dot is the object. And apparently, surveys with the Hubble and some other ground-based surveys, when it went in front of a few stars, they're expecting that it's probably a lump, kind of a, yeah, here we go. It's probably a lopsided object, or it might be two small sort of rocky moons kind of orbiting each other. It might even have a small little satellite moon of its own. So it's going to be really interesting to see this when it flies by January 1st. So yeah, looking forward to that. So here's the question. You're a vacuum tube manufacturer in the heyday of old radios, and you've got this vacuum tube production factory in Pennsylvania, and you've got this policy that all of your tubes that you sell are going to be tested and guaranteed to work, which means that you've got a lot of reject tubes. So many reject tubes, in fact, that you're just throwing them into a pile in the yard in the back of the factory, and over the course of years and years and years, you end up with a mound of tubes that is so overwhelmingly huge that it's got the attention of everyone who knows about your tubes. And so at night and on the weekends, people are coming in and they're grabbing tubes out of the pile, and then they're selling those tubes as new tubes when they're reject tubes. What are you going to do? What will you do? Well, Sylvania came up with a solution. They decided that they were going to need something to take on this mountain of tubes that they had piled up, and they invented the Sylvania Tube Crusher. That's right. It's a tube crushing machine they built that would crush tubes by the shovelful. And they ran this machine apparently for years. Look at all the tubes on the floor here. Just rolling around. But then leave the conveyor belt here going into the crusher. And then there's a guy here, he's got like the crushed junk. Man, can you imagine in this room? This room is filled with glass dust. Just glass dust. Imagine breathing glass dust all day. And not just any glass dust, but like crushed glass dust. Man, the Sylvania tube crusher. It was such a fascinating idea. I gave the idea to Hackaday years ago, and they actually wrote an article about it. But yeah, it was on my mind thinking about the Sylvania tube crusher. Just nothing like that today. Nothing at all. So that's what I was thinking about. How about a few hand grenades? Yeah, recycling. Recycling is not a word that they used back in the 1930s. Recycling. All those tubes. Indeed, indeed. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Mm-hmm. So, we're 29 minutes in. I'm officially in the orange. So, looks like people are coming home from work and starting to suck up bandwidth. So, yeah, that's pretty much the thing. There's also, there's a great article, too. I couldn't find it. I don't know if it was in the Post or the Times or... It was in an American newspaper. It was an article about plastics, which was fascinating, about the science of trying to preserve plastics, because in museums and such, a lot of the late 20th century art, especially during the pop art era, a lot of art was made with plastics. A lot of them very sort of more volatile than people realized, and it's now like 60 years into the plastic age in art, all this artwork is starting to deteriorate. And they also talked about the spacesuits, you know, the early spacesuits, and the Apollo era suits that had a lot of PVC and neoprene in the inner layers that are now disintegrating, just because the elastomers have propagated out of the plastics and they're becoming brittle. And can shatter like plaster almost when they dry out. So there's this scramble to try and preserve artifacts made of plastics. People really didn't, and it's kind of interesting too, because the article, they talk about the difference between the eras of plastics, between the cellulose acetate era and the polystyrene polyethylene era. Most of my frames are actually cellulose acetate. I actually prefer cellulose acetate. I think these are cellulose acetate, even though they're clear. But pretty much all my eyeglass frames are cellulose acetate. So I'm fascinated with the technology of plastics. So called vulcanizing. You can vulcanize certain kinds of natural rubber, yeah? But vulcanizing is a process. Hey, Europe. I see my, I'm back in the green. Back in the green, okay. It was starting to conk out there on my feed. We're hanging in there. Nylon, the UV, yeah. Ultraviolet breaks down all plastics, pretty much. Because ultraviolet light will break the polymer chains. You know, the plastics are made of long polymer chains, and ultraviolet light, it's, The far ultraviolet will break those chains, and but most plastic will simply disintegrate because the elastomers propagate out. They slowly migrate out of the plastic, and once the elastomers leave, the plastic is extremely brittle, and the plastic will also shrink in size. So if you have plastic parts, like mechanical parts that have to interconnect, if you ever notice some of the older, if you have something old and made of plastic from the 50s or 60s. The parts don't fit anymore. They get loose, you know, and start jiggling because the plastics, as the plastic ages, those polymer strains, which are sort of randomly sort of intertwined like matting on a molecular level, they gradually, you know, just from atomic vibration, you know, the atoms are always kind of wiggling around. They sort of wiggle themselves into tighter configurations, and the plastics just get they shrink. It's another weird thing about plastics. Look, like I got another, more trolls. Yeah. More trolls. Why are you trolling me? You know? Just leave. It's like, it's the one thing I don't understand about the trolling age. It's like, why be on a broadcast that upsets you? Just fucking leave. You know, that's, as the parents of my generation used to say, that's why the TV set has the off switch. That's pretty much it. It's 34 minutes. We're going to wind it up. I'm not going to... I'm going to be shooting those other videos over the weekend and such. And taking a little bit of time off for the Labor Day weekend and getting back to it next week. Does anybody have any questions on the chat before I leave for the great planet Earth? I am due back on Earth later tonight. Oh, audio is 5x5. That's cool. All right. Any questions? Any questions? Hey. I'll show that. Profanity's allowed. I just use profanity. Yeah, my chat is blinking on and off. Okay, well, there's no questions. So, I'm going to sign off from the moon. Head back to the great planet Earth. And, any interest in scope clocks? Not entirely. People make them, but no. I guess I use oscilloscopes too much to really fancy them as anything but what I generally use them for. Oh, okay, the chat's going now. Alright, yeah, well, thanks everybody for tuning in. It's kind of a light live chat this week, just because it is, in the United States, the long Labor Day weekend, so... Not going to have a whole lot of people in the U.S. tuning in at this hour. But I'll be back. Maybe next week. We'll see. Anyway, that's it. Bye!
Bob, all these big boulders around here that I've looked at are the same rock type. Geophone module. Can't imagine. Okay.
Fly DBA.
Go ahead.